Hello, TV viewers. This is another edition of One Man Show. Each and every week I try to include footage of local sites and landmarks in and around the viewing area. Seen behind me tonight here is the Cornerstone Construction Project located in Parma Heights. In a year or two, when it's completed, it will be a vast retail and living complex situated on the corners of Pearl Road and West 130th Streets, again in Parma Heights. But enough of that. Part 2 tonight of AERO EXPO 2004. That's right, the second half of last week's show featuring vintage World War II aircraft such as the B-17, the B-24, the B-29. Oh my goodness, we even have a glimpse of a B-25 and a C-47, an interview with veteran pilots that flew these great World War II aircraft. One Man Show is loaded in the computer and ready to go. All I have to do is hit play. Strap in, because One Man Show starts now.
Have come home to roost. Thousands of those made in Akron by Goodyear during the war. You can smell the gasoline mixture in the wind where we're standing right now. Just the smell of the exhaust.
I'm standing next to the Corsair, one of several that will be coming back for the special reunion here at the Akron Air Show. Many of you may not know this, but the Corsair was built in the thousands by Goodyear, as well as other parts around the country, but the bulk of the production numbers came from Akron. Because of a special award ceremony that's being held at this year's show, this plane has been specially painted with the Spirit of Akron name on the front engine cowl. And now that's especially rare, and the plane never went into combat with that name, nor did any plane really do that. But for the special events here, they've put the special name Spirit of Akron for the festivities that are taking place. And I'm told that this is one of the finest examples of a Corsair that's been restored, a restored warbird in the entire United States and the world for that fact. Let's go over here to the wing, and we're going to get a shot of some of this fine restoration work. In fact, this plane is just weeks off of winning multiple awards, just short of the Rolls-Royce trophy, rather, which is given to the top airplane each and every year. And you can see the detail right down to the brass cotter keys and the cadmium finished bolts and the OD, that's olive drab, green paint on the inside. The bare metal parts that swivel and move are still bare metal, just as if it had rolled off the assembly line. As if we just stepped back into time and broke open the time capsule to look at a plane that may have been built just like this off the assembly lines in Akron at Goodyear. But this Corsair, again, is one of the finest examples of a restored warbird that you're ever going to see. And it's my special treat to bring it to you here on One Man Show. Boy, this plane is beautiful. You can see the munitions racks up on the wings. And again, for a lot of the younger listeners and viewers out there, the Corsair was at first going to be an aircraft fighter plane, but it didn't work out for the U.S., so they ended up making it a land-based fighter, but the British took this plane, modified it, and made it to where it could actually be used by aircraft carriers. And then by 1943, the U.S. made the same modifications, and many of the Corsairs did see carrier duty at that time. But as we swing around here to the front of the plane, and as Bill was pointing out, our cameraman, and he's a war historian in his own right, Bill pointed out this is one of the few examples of having drop tanks like this that you'll see on a Corsair at any show in the United States. And it's right here within a 30-minute drive of everybody in the viewing area here tonight. a pair of drop wing tanks, which would extend the range of this plane for hundreds and maybe even 1,000 miles, depending on the theater it was in and what the bomb load of the plane was at time of takeoff. But even the air inlets in the wings, the honeycomb work of the stainless steel grills, the louvers, everything about this plane has been painstakingly restored. The color tips on the propeller. And let's swing around here and get a shot of the engine where you can look inside, see the cylinder heads, the fuel lines. It's a Pratt & Whitney, all original, completely restored. And again, it's one thing to go to the Cleveland Air Show, but one of the best kept secrets in Northeast Ohio is the Akron Air Show every June, where you have one of the greatest assemblages of vintage warbirds anywhere in the United States at any given time. Many of the old timers here have told me that. They themselves and even the plane owners like coming here to Akron because of the atmosphere, the wide open space, and just the collection, the sheer number of vintage aircraft that find their way here each and every year. Well, now we're with Blackie, the one man that everybody here at the air show says that we need to talk to and that probably knows the most about Fifi here. How many years have you been associated with this plane?
I've been associated with B-29s, one like it, since World War II.
Wow.
Since 1943.
What was your first experience with a B-29?
I trained for certain parts of it. They showed me a photo, top secret. I said it won't fly.
Just like that?
Mm-hmm, just like that.
Now, who was that initial conversation with?
Oh, well, that was with the Air Force themselves. Everybody that flew this airplane originally, it was hand-picked, and it was top secret. We could not tell our family what we were doing.
When was the plane first designed? Because obviously, a machine of this size, of this many moving parts, isn't designed overnight. What year were the blueprints first drawn up for the B-29?
There's a lot of controversy on that. I go back to 1936 when the designers were thinking they might need a bigger airplane than the B-17, and it's a Boeing aircraft. So they put it on the drawing board, I think it was the 145, and then put it aside because there was no engines. But and anticipated maybe there would be a bigger plane. In 1939, the War Department and President said we need an airplane that'll fly 4,000 miles and higher, faster than anything, carry a bigger bomb load. And so there were several companies that competed, and Boeing had a head start. They designed the plane, of course, right then and there from the starting blueprints. And they got the design. They got 250 airplanes ordered before they could even get a prototype out.
Nice. Of the bombers of World War II, we have the B-24, there's the B-17, you have the B-29. What makes this plane distinctly better and head and shoulders a better bomber than the others?
Well, we were pressurized in the first place. We could fly 30,000, 35,000 feet dressed like we are now, just like you can commercial, heated and air-conditioned. Every man aboard was in that position. Our missions were up to 18 hours and sometimes, and spy ships, 24 hours.
Wow.
We could do our work a lot more proficient, couldn't we? Besides, we had a computerized gun system on this airplane we never had before. Everything is remote control and computerized. Any time that you got your target within your gun sight there, the computer's working all the time when you're in range. And we could share these. We could share up to two turrets on any one target. It was really a great piece of machinery.
What's the story, and I think the History Channel ran this a couple of months ago, the story about how the Russians copied this design to make their own B-29, and I've seen some of the footage. It actually looks like our B-29.
I talked to the engineers on that, and I said, how close? And they said, right to the rivet. In other words, they had some patches on there from bullets. They mm-hmm. even put those patches on there.
Wow. On those long flights, up to 18 hours, obviously normal amenities that we would take for granted, such as going to the bathroom, sleeping, eating, was there any accommodations made for the crews on those long flights for those things to take place?
We had what we call a porta potty. It's just about like we have now. It was in the back, but the first guy that used it had to clean it. However, on our first missions, we dare not leave our position at all because we didn't have fighter escort, we didn't have control of the skies, or the, and sometimes we had a tough time being accurate. Besides that, those jet streams over Japan, different altitudes, different directions of winds, and different velocity all the way down. So we had to start going lower and lower.
We're speaking with Blackie Blackburn here at the Akron Air Show. What brought Fifi to the air show here in Akron?
Every year we make 25 to 30 stops to show the airplane to really tell people what it was really like and give an education. See, not many people know what the B-29 did other than the atomic bombs. And so we do this every year, and it's very rewarding.
Do you think we'll get to see Fifi back here in the future?
You know, I hope so.
We've talked a lot about the aircraft. Let's talk a little bit about yourself. What unit were you with and some of the specifics as far as the time you served with the 29s? And also, you were just telling me a moment ago that five and a half aircraft shot down with you.
Actually, you know, I was in the 73rd Bomb Wing on Saipan, and that was the first unit to bomb Japan proper, Tokyo and so on, since the Doolittle Raid, of course. I was on the first mission. And I was on the last. We came home after 20 and set up a lead crew school because they couldn't teach us how to fly in combat in the States. We learned a lot of stuff just by flying. So so-called veterans, we came back and set up a lead crew school and went back after 20, and my 35th was the day before they signed the armistice.
20.
And he said many they come from the front. They could not get up to the altitude at first. They finally supercharged, come from the front, single file. A lot of damage being done that you didn't see because they left you and you didn't see what happened.
Wow.
When they left.
And the automatic gun sight, that really made a difference, didn't it?
Oh, absolutely.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. You can just pick up where you were as far as your crew position.
Okay, my crew position in World War II was a gun commander, which distributes the guns to the various gunners as needed. We could fire up to two turrets on any one target if available. And they call out a direction of an attack, and I'd give them the guns to fire. We shared them. And I was also a flight engineer after we took Iwo Jima. We didn't need guns and bombs and so on, so I became a flight engineer. I went to school prior to that, and I assisted them in the pilot position when they wanted to rest, relief.
Standing next to the plane all the years later, do memories still flood back to you?
You know, they do. Actually, when I first got out, I said, I don't want any more part of this. I threw everything in a pile. I had a lot of trauma. A lot of the buddies died and all that good stuff. And so I forgot about it. I didn't even tell my family about it until about 1991. And when I got involved with this type of an airplane, with this one especially, and I thought, hey, they're trying to rewrite history. I'm going to tell it as it is.
Yes.
So I'm actually the only one from Saipan that's still with 29s.
Excellent.
From the convection currents, from the heat.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Which plane do you think is better, the 29 or the 36? 36, I know, came after the 29.
I put my money on the 29. Mm-hmm. 36 actually wasn't in operation.
Didn't prove itself, did it?
These are beautiful
too, too
planes.
Too complicated, really.
Is it nice flying at night in one of these, being able to look up at the stars and knowing you're surrounded by such a beautiful machine?
And we see St. Elmo's fire. Tips of the props all fire and sparks all over the plane.
Wow.
It's really neat.
That is neat. And I bet the first time you go up and you see that, it has to be a little scary too, though.
Absolutely.
You know, when you see that St. Elmo's fire off the blades.
First time you ever see it, yes.
I'd be petrified. You'd say, geez, there's something wrong with a plane.
Well, there's no amperage, so, I mean, it doesn't bother you. Mm-hmm. Nice blue, though. They're about like that. A nice blue spark.
Is that caused by the static?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Tony's were probably one of the best at altitude. They're an inline engine like the P-51. They had a twin engine Irving that was pretty good too. So I got two Tonys, confirmed two Tonys, and then four Oscars.
An Oscar is?
Is a fighter.
Oh, is it?
Just keep a wide shot.
Now, on the B-24 here, Diamond Lil, let's get a shot of the 50 caliber machine gun that's in the nose of this aircraft. It's a single gun, and you can see the bullets there in the belt that feeds into the machine gun. Now, the red bullet, which is basically every fifth one, is a tracer. That way the machine gunners, particularly in low light situations, Bill, let's pan up above there real quick. Look at there. Some of the stunt team planes that will be performing throughout the three-day event here at MAPS coming in for a landing.
Is that one of the Ford-built B-24s?
It looks like they're going to line that plane up right over by the Akron police cruisers. What a beautiful aircraft. So, has your buddy ever flown before?
Actually, he's a pilot.
Oh, is he? But he's never been in a Dauntless, huh?
Fantastic. It's a new experience.
You're going to buy him dinner after this experience? There he is, hanging on.
Another fun air show, sure, up there at Yankee Air Museum, August 9th and 10th. Pay a visit to Thunder over Detroit.
You can see the old DC-3, I believe it is, over there. Is it a 3 or an 8? I can't never remember the two, but it's kind of like the planes on Band of Brothers the guys jumped out of, except it had olive drab and the white stripes on the wings and the fuselage.
You gotta hang out for that heritage flight if you can.
Pick up the brochures they've got, and pick up the Wonder Fix workout. Celebrate the flight. It's a passion to experience everything. Right from the beginning, space travel.
This is very, very exciting here. For the first time ever at the Akron Air Show, we have a B-24, a B-29, and a B-17 all together at the same time. And the B-17 is right there seen taxiing in behind us. Oh man, this is better than a life's worth of birthdays to see all these warbirds together. It's just been pointed out to me that the one wheel is not turning on the plane. Well, we have plenty of tape and plenty of TV show, and you know what, Jack? 40 minutes of you certainly wouldn't do justice of all the tales that you can tell.
Oh.
And we're talking with Jack Bradshaw, who's been in 5 different Air Forces. Tell us which Air Forces you've been a member of.
All right. I was a Yank in the Royal Air Force. Then they called me a Limey when I transferred to the 8th Air Force, but they called that the Army Air Corps. And then I went to the Confederate Air Force, and then the Commemorative Air Force. Oh, I forgot about the USAAF. So that makes it number 5.
Now, were you with the 8th Air Force?
I was eventually, yes. I went over there in 41 as a volunteer for the RAF and stayed with them about 3 years. Got married over in England and I couldn't afford the RAF anymore. I went in as a sergeant pilot, made about $64 a month. I transferred to the US Air Force as a first lieutenant, made $370. So it made a big difference.
Now, being with the 8th Air Force, were you ever in combat as a fighter pilot where you had a chance to shoot down an enemy aircraft?
I had a few shots, yes. I flew with the 56 fighter group, Zemke's Wolfpack, and most of the big aces came out of there. I wasn't one of them. But yeah, I had a number of shots. I got a couple of 190s and a few damaged here and there, 109.
Now, when you say you got a couple of Focke-Wulf 190s and a 109, actually downed, were you downed on enemy aircraft?
Well, the 109 was downed, and one 190, the other was damaged. And so I was not an ace. You had to have five for an ace. I did get a couple of buzz bombs, though, what they called V1s, flying Spitfires with the Royal Air Force.
Now, were those as easy to take down as we see on the History Channel, where they were relatively easy to come up from behind and shoot down from a fighter pilot's perspective?
Yes, if you could see them. The biggest problem, they came in sort of mucky weather, and they'd be in and out of cloud, so they were hard to spot. Once, if it was clear, you dove down on them. They came in around 350 to 400 miles an hour top, huh? And they didn't take any evasive action, so they were if you spotted them, they were pretty easy to shoot down.
We're talking with Jack Bradshaw here at the Akron Air Show. Jack, is this your first time here in Akron at this show?
It's my first time here, yes. I've been to a lot of air shows, but this is my first at Akron.
Well, we'd definitely be interested to get your gauge as to how good of a show this really is. Back to your flying days, though, what's the one memory that stands out for you that you still think fondly of?
Well, I guess flying a P-47 with the 56, because it was the next to the Spitfire, which was my favorite airplane. The Thunderbolt was my number two and the most rugged airplane built.
And you say you met your wife over in England, huh?
Yeah, and I named my airplanes after her. She was called the Yorkshire Lass because she came from Yorkshire.
Oh, that's tremendous. Jack, thank you very much for sharing those stories with us. Jack Bradshaw, ladies and gentlemen, you're watching One Man Show, a special edition on the Akron Air Show and the Mapped Air Museum in Summit County.
Word has it that we have some air show programs, a couple extra cases. So from now till show closing, which will be around 5 to 6 p.m., all of our historic guests, and it's a bargain. It'd be a bargain at $10, but now we're selling what we got left for just $1. So catch the event staff that are selling the air show programs and get a deal. To the original American volunteer pilots. We need a ride with Dick Rossi. We have Dora Murray in Washington. New women air service pilots who are responsible for bringing the aircraft.
Hey, I tell you what, we've talked with a lot of people here that have been associated with Fifi today, but now we have the pilot or one of the pilots, Paul Stoikoff here, and guess what? He's right from Fairview Park, Ohio. Paul, thanks for spending a minute with us here.
You're welcome. Thanks for coming out. We appreciate you spending the time with us. We hope to have a lot of people out this weekend so they learn some of the history of what went on in World War II, take a tour of the airplane, and maybe get the chance to sit in the pilot seat.
Now, you're kind of a big fellow here, kind of like an NBA player or a football linebacker. How in the world do you ever fit into the cockpit of Fifi, which we showed our listeners earlier in the show? Just how tight those confines can be.
Well, I'm a pretty tight fit. I can't imagine the guys in the war, although, as you know, you've met some of the veterans here today, and they were a bit smaller in stature. The one thing you do have to take consideration, they were wearing the leather jackets, the flak vest, all the gear, which we don't today when we fire. You know, when we go out and fly her today.
How special is this for you to be from Fairview and to be here in Northeast Ohio with Fifi? This has to be kind of nice because Fifi hasn't been to this air show, to my knowledge, before.
That's correct. I don't know that we have been. I consider it a great honor and a privilege. I'm happy that, you know, we can continue the history on so that the new generations coming along, they hear the stories from their grandfathers, in some cases their fathers still to this day, about what they did. The main difference between as a group as the Commemorative Air Force and some of the others here this weekend, Yankee Air Force and such, is that we go out and we fly the aircraft. People can hear them, see them, actually smell the burning oil when we start the engines. As you know, when you go to a museum, thousands, hundreds of thousands of people get to see the aircraft. Doing this every summer, we get millions of people that get to see the airplanes.
Do you think we'll get a chance to see Fifi again? I know I just asked Blackie that, but, you know, being an actual pilot of this plane, you think you'll get a chance to bring this back here to Northeast Ohio again in future years?
I sure hope so. We're very glad that they invited us. I would love to bring her back every year if we could.
Nice. Paul Stoikoff, Fairview Park resident, and one of the pilots of Fifi, the B-29, here at the Akron Air Show. Well, who doesn't like a fireworks display? I, like many people, enjoy fireworks just as much as the next guy. One Man Show is proud to present fireworks here as we wrap up the final few minutes of our show.